We all know that physical parts do not interpenetrate each other in this world. But in numerical simulation, contact penetration may exist. So it's important to be able to understand and to check this output carefully. The question we'll try to answer in this Ansys how-to video is, why do we sometimes see a non-zero penetration result, and how are we to interpret this information? Ansys Mechanical offers several different formulations to enforce compatibility at a contact interface. Among these methods, pure penalty and augmented Lagrange are penalty-based methods, and they're expected to produce small, non-zero penetration. In this video, we'll mainly focus on these penalty-based contact methods then. The penalty method is a mathematical approach of enforcing contact without constraining it. Simply put, for surface A penetrating into surface B, there will be a penalty. And this penalty is the introduction of a restoring force at the interface. The magnitude of this restoring force is proportional to the magnitude of the penetration. The formula for the restoring force of a pure penalty-based contact is similar to that of a virtual spring, where Kn is the stiffness of the spring and Xp is the displacement. For example, with a spring, if there is no displacement, no force is generated. In the case of contacting surfaces, if there is no penetration, there is no restoring force applied. Hence, the restoring force is the function of contact element stiffness and the amount of penetration. Ideally, for an infinite stiffness, one would get zero penetration. This is not numerically possible, though. Which brings us back to our original question, how are we to interpret non-zero contact penetration in finite element analysis result? We should always review contact penetration result and verify that they are very small as compared with local geometric dimensions, local displacement result, and other critical results, like initial interference or boat pretension adjustment, if applicable. Of course, one should always ensure that forces and moments are balanced. Now, let's get our hands on the simulation and touch upon the points we just discussed. We're looking at a contact problem between a ball and a wall geometry. Initially, we can see that there's a distance between the two parts. The wall here is fixed on the four side faces, and for the ball, a displacement control is added to it in negative y direction, so that it will approach the wall and will be in contact with it. And the ball will continue to move in negative y direction after the contact is detected, and the wall is expected to deform accordingly under the contact force generated. Let's have a look at the contact definition here. A frictionless contact is defined between the ball surface and the wall surface. Frictionless contact is nonlinear. It allows the contact status to change, meaning that the solver continuously detects if the contact surfaces are close enough to be called as in contact or far enough to be treated as open. Also, frictionless sliding is allowed between the parts, although we don't have sliding in this case because of the defined boundary conditions. We specify that the ball surface is the contact surface and the wall surface is the target surface, because the wall has larger area and coarser mesh here. Also, the material of the wall is said to be softer than the ball in this case. The contact formulation used here is said to be program controlled. As we mentioned before, the default choice of contact method is the augmented Lagrange method, which is a penalty-based one. Now, let's solve the problem and take a look at the results. First of all, a quick check of the total deformation. The deformation pattern seems as expected. We also need to check the force balance of the simulation. We can drag the fixed boundary conditions on the wall and the displacement control of the ball from the analysis setting to the results part. The reaction forces from the two boundary conditions match well. This indicates that global force balance is reached. Now, drag the frictionless contact to the results part 2. Set the contact force to be extracted from contact element. You can see that the contact force matches the reaction forces from the boundary conditions. So we can say that the ball itself is balanced with the contact force and boundary reaction force. Same thing for the wall part. Now, let's insert a contact tool in result part. Here, we can trace the condition of the contact pair. For example, the contact status changes from yellow to orange during the deformation, meaning that the contact was open initially and later came into contact. We can also view the pressure generated between the contact pair. You can see that as the two parts are pushed together harder, the contact pressure grows as expected. There are some other options to evaluate contact. For example, gap, sliding distance, etc. Now, let's have a look at the contact penetration value for this problem. Clearly, the penetration starts from zero and continuously grows along the deformation. The maximum penetration occurs on the center of the contact region and reaches 1.42 mm. To view this penetration more directly, let's go to the total deformation result. Create a section plan that cuts through the ball and the wall, so that we can see the side view. Zooming a little bit, the penetration is better visualized here. As we discussed before, for penalty-based method, penetration is expected. It is a part of the formulation where restoring force of contact is formed. One should always evaluate the penetration value to decide if it's acceptable for the analysis or design. For example, we need to answer questions like, what's the ratio between the amount of penetration and the local deformation? What's the ratio between penetration and the dimension of the geometry part? And questions like, would the local deformation results be affected by the amount of contact penetration? For this model, the penetration is 1.42 mm. First of all, let's compare this value with the deformation result. Looking at the total deformation contour plot, you will find that the maximum deformation in y direction is 15 mm. However, we should notice that this value includes the rigid motion of the ball before being in contact with the wall. So we should exclude this part of movement and use the local deformation around contact area to be the denominator. Here, what we can do is to extract deformation on the top surface of the wall part. The maximum deformation here is 38.77 mm. With 1.42 mm penetration, the percentage of penetration is 3.7% compared to local deformation. We can also check the ratio between the penetration value and the dimension of the wall. The thickness of the wall is 50 mm, so the ratio here is 1.42 over 50, which is 2.8%. Both the values are not small enough to say that the penetration is totally negligible in this simulation. For this model, the 1.42 mm penetration result is obtained based on the program-controlled normal stiffness and penetration tolerance. This means the penetration tolerance is automatically calculated and is based on the material properties and underlying mesh size. For example, a coarse mesh may have a larger allowable penetration tolerance compared to a finer mesh. To reduce the calculated penetration, of course, we can refine the mesh and rerun the problem. Or we can manually increase the normal stiffness or tighten the penetration tolerance value. For example, if we put a limit of penetration value of 0.5 mm here and rerun the simulation, you can see that the penetration is effectively reduced to about 0.41 mm. Now, let's see how the deformation, stress, and reaction forces are affected. The deformation of the wall is increased by 1 mm. The equivalent stress is increased by 0.02 MPa, and the reaction force is increased by 28 N. Such a change in result can also prove that the previous penetration is subjected to improvement. Now, the ratio between penetration and local deformation is 1%, and the ratio between penetration and wall thickness is 0.8%, which is a more satisfying result. However, we should know that such manual penetration tolerance put extra constraint to the system and might result in increase of iterations to solve the problem or even fail to converge. As we mentioned before, to have reasonable contact force, the penetration value and the contact stiffness should be balanced. Extremely small penetration will result in extremely large contact stiffness, which makes the contact force very sensitive to small changes in penetration. Another workaround to reduce penetration is to switch from penalty-based method to normal Lagrange method, whose formulation does not depend on penetration. Now, we can see that the penetration value remains almost zero for this problem. The question might be that, why not just stick to normal Lagrange method instead of using penalty-based method? Well, the penalty-based method has the merit of easy convergence for nonlinear problem. Penalty-based contact is comparatively soft as the contact force is calculated based on a spring-like formulation. So in cases when normal Lagrange method cannot converge appropriately or needs too many iterations, users might find penalty-based method preferred option. In fact, in many cases, the program control settings for contacting Ansys Mechanical works sufficiently well. We might not need to tweak anything after evaluate the results. To summarize, default penalty-based methods are elegant in their simplicity and helpful in that they will not mathematically over-constrain a model like the normal Lagrange method. However, one should always expect a non-zero penetration result at a contacting interface. It is an inherited limitation of the penalty method. We should always confirm that this penetration is negligible as compared to other critical results in the model. If you find this video helpful, please like, comment, and subscribe. To find more information about contact or other topics, check out our channel for more how-to videos and visit ansys.com/courses today.